I just spent the past 3 or whatever hours.
Welcome everyone to Columbia Law School. Thank you for joining us. I'm Tariq Ismail. I'm the Counterterrorism and Human Rights Fellow at the Law School. At the first, want to thank the co-sponsors of tonight's event, in no specific order, the Bill of Rights Defense Committee, Drum, Daisy's Rising Up and Moving, CUNY's Creating Law Enforcement Accountability and Responsibility, or CLEAR Clinic, the National Lawyers Guild New York City Chapter, and the Rights Working Group. Special thanks also goes to CARE New York and Lanier and the staff at CARE for helping put all this together. By way of very brief introduction, the Columbia Human Rights Institute serves as the center of research, scholarship, and practice in the area of human rights at Columbia Law School. But it was through our work on counterterrorism and human rights, and particularly our work and research on counterterrorism prosecutions, that we initially came in contact with Trevor, who's going to discuss his newly released book tonight. Trevor is an award-winning journalist, and he's the founder and co-director of the Florida Center for Investigative Reporting. He wrote an incredibly important article in Mother Jones magazine, which was published last year, which led to the book that he's going to talk about today, The Terror Factor, Inside the FBI's Manufactured War on Terrorism. And here's Trevor Aaronson.
Thank you for having me. So there are a lot of cases that I discuss in the book, and many of them are patently absurd, and some of those are very difficult to explain in a talk like this. But there's one I like to talk about because it can kind of boil it down and is perhaps the most absurd out of people that the FBI and the Department of Justice have termed terrorists since 9/11. And it involves this man in suburban Illinois named Derek Sharif. And Derek was in his early 20s, and he'd recently converted to Islam, and his family was entirely against it, and actually gave him an ultimatum: you know, you can stay within the family, or you have to renounce your religion. And Derek chose Islam. And so he no longer had a place to live. He was working at a video game store, earning close to minimum wage, and it just so happened that his car had broken down, so he was in a tough spot. And it's unclear why the FBI became interested in Derek, but what we know is that they sent in an informant to his video game store, and the informant struck up a conversation. That informant happened to have been a former gang member who had dealt drugs and had worked off that charge and was now working for the FBI for money. And the informant, in the conversation with him, says, you know, how are you doing? And Derek explains his tough lot, and the informant says, well, I've got a place you can live. I've got a car, you know, you can eat my food. Why don't you come over? And Derek, nowhere to go, car broken down, and also being, you know, newly and in his mind devoutly religious, thought this was the work of God because it was the day before Ramadan. And Derek says, yes, I'd love to go live with you. So he goes and stays with the informant. All the bills are being paid for by the FBI. And over the course of months, the informant slowly stokes in Derek his anger. And Derek is angry. He doesn't quite know why. He's angry of U.S. foreign policy. He's angry of the treatment of Muslims by the U.S. government here and abroad. And the informant says, well, what are you going to do about it? And Derek says angrily, I'm going to kill a judge. And of course, Derek didn't know the names of any judges. And the informant then says, well, what if we attack a shopping mall? And Derek got very excited about that idea. He's like, yes, we should attack a shopping mall. And that became the beginning of what seemed to be a very good sting operation for the FBI. Except there was a problem in the sense that the FBI in these sting operations needs more than talk. They need some kind of overt act. And they needed him to acquire weapons. Well, the problem was that Derek didn't have any money. As mentioned, he was flat broke. But he did have these old stereo speakers, and it was the only thing that he had of any value. And the informant says to him, well, I know this arms dealer, and I think we could get some grenades, and I think if you brought your stereo speakers to him, he'd take the stereo speakers and say, okay, trade. And, you know, I don't know much about black market arms, but I'm pretty sure that no arms dealer is going to take old stereo speakers for grenades. But Derek didn't seem to know that. And Derek then says, okay, let's go. And so the informant and Derek go to the suburban shopping mall in Illinois, and in the parking lot is a man portraying himself as an arms dealer, and he's got his box. Of course, it wasn't an arms dealer, it was an undercover FBI agent. Derek hands over the grenade, or I'm sorry, Derek hands over the speakers. The agent takes them and hands over the five grenades. They were all inert, but they looked real, and Derek walked away, just as FBI agents storm in and arrest him. And they charged him with conspiracy to use a weapon of mass destruction, and he's now serving 25 years in prison. What I think, one of the things that happened in that case that I found particularly revelatory in the work I was doing was that before he was arrested, and as they're talking about their plot to bomb a shopping mall with grenades, Derek says to the informant, you know, if it wasn't for you, referring to the informant's ability to get him grenades, I would probably just end up stabbing someone with a steak knife. And what I thought was so interesting about that was that it was, my argument in these cases is that the FBI ultimately prosecutes men as terrorists who never have any capability of becoming terrorists on their own. And here was Derek Sharif saying, the best I can do is stab someone with a steak knife. But through this elaborate sting operation, the FBI was able to prosecute Derek as someone who was about to bomb a shopping mall with grenades and portray him to the public as a dangerous terrorist whose threat was thwarted only through the hard work of FBI agents. So Derek's case was one of many I'd seen since really the middle of the last decade. And there was some reporting done on these cases, and all that I'd seen was very anecdotal. It would talk about a sting case here and a sting case there, and there were questions of how many people actually posed a threat. And so I decided to pursue a project that would try to figure out, since 9/11, how many real terrorists have there been? How many people like Najib al-Azazi, who came very close to bombing the subway stations here, or Faisal Shahzad, who came close to bombing Times Square? How many had there been of these dangerous terrorists? And how many Derek Sharifs had there been? People that had no capacity for terrorism other than the FBI providing them with everything they would need. But a problem I ran into early in the research was, how do you really define what a terrorism case is? Because the idea of the term terrorism had kind of been conflated in so many ways. And I didn't want to build a database of cases that the DOJ could then say, you know, well, that's not a terrorism case, or we don't consider that a terrorism case, and then, you know, most of my reporting is thereby flawed. But I ran into some luck when, in wanting to prosecute Khalid Sheikh Mohammed here in Manhattan, Congress put up a fuss and said, you know, how can we put on a fair and secure trial of a terrorist like Khalid Sheikh Mohammed? And the Justice Department and Eric Holder provided to Congress a list of, at the time, 408 names of defendants that they said had been prosecuted successfully for terrorism. And also included in that was how the DOJ defined what a terrorism case was in their own internal record keeping. They had two categories. You know, one was things you would expect, weapon of mass destruction, hijacking an airplane, those types of crimes. The others were just about anything you could imagine as long as the defendant had some sort of connection to terrorism. You know, so for example, if they got someone on an immigration charge or lying to the FBI, but they had evidence to suggest they were connected to international terrorism in some way, then that was a terrorism case. And so I had this list of 400 defendants. I also had the criteria for how the DOJ defined terrorism. So my goal, starting in 2009, 2010, was to build it out to the 10th anniversary of 9/11 and try to figure out, add to the cases using the DOJ's criteria, and really figure out how these cases broke down. How many involved real terrorists, Faisal Shahzad, Najib al-Azazi, and how many involved Derek Sharif? And what we know from this is that in the decade after 9/11, there were approximately 500 terrorism defendants. The majority of cases really weren't people that you would consider dangerous or an immediate threat. They were prosecuted for immigration charges or lying to the FBI. But there were a handful of real terrorists. And when, out of 500 I looked at, I could point to a handful of cases that I thought I could say that guy was dangerous. You know, the shoe bomber, Richard Reed, Najib al-Azazi, Faisal Shahzad. So we have these five or so cases of really dangerous guys. But then we also have 150 Derek Sharifs, 150 people who were targeted by informants, at some point said they wanted to commit some sort of act of terrorism, never had the ability to commit terrorism on their own, but an informant was there to facilitate it. So of those 150, 50 actually involved an informant that I would term an agent provocateur, which is to say, like Derek Sharif, they provided not only the means, you know, the weapons, the transportation, but also the idea itself. They went and said, here's where you can go, here's what we should go and do. And ultimately, what the FBI has been very successful in doing in these cases is to make it seem as if there is this great threat of terrorism coming almost specifically from Muslim communities through the announcement of these terrible, horrific sounding cases. You know, every time there's an operation that's announced, DOJ will say, here's everything he was about to do. He was about to bomb the subway system. He was about to bomb a downtown skyscraper. And it sounds awful, and they post their pictures on there of their mugshots, and they seem really scary. But they're really not once you go and look at the cases and the evidence that's provided in those cases. And so as part of this research, I went to the FBI, and I showed them these cases. And I said, look at Derek Sharif. How can you consider him a terrorist? And the FBI's response, and understanding this is critical to, I think, understanding why they pursue these cases, is that Derek Sharif could have been a threat. That the FBI believes that Al-Qaeda and affiliated terrorist groups are no longer capable of carrying out a sophisticated, large-scale attack like 9/11. They're no longer capable of training terrorists overseas, sending them here, and having them all work together in this horrific crime. But what they are capable of is basically franchising Al-Qaeda. You know, the FBI refers to this as Al-Qaeda-ism versus Al-Qaeda. The FBI believes that the greatest threat now is not so much that cell as it is some guy in his apartment right now who's angry, he wants to commit some sort of act of terrorism, and he goes online and he reads extremist websites, he watches jihadi videos, and he becomes inspired and then commits some act of terrorism. And then Al-Qaeda or its affiliates can claim credit, even though they may have not had any awareness that that was going to happen before it did. And what the FBI considers this is, when they decide whether to pursue a case or not, they have what they can call a spectrum, which is they're looking for people who are on the sympathizer side of the terrorism spectrum, as they call it, where they sympathize with international terrorist groups, they would like to get involved in terrorism in some way. And then there's the other side, which is operator, where people who are actually able and capable of doing something. And what the FBI hopes in these sting operations is to find them before they step over that line to operator. And as a result of this, we've had this flurry of sting cases. You know, as I said, 5 perhaps real terrorists and 150 sting cases. But none of these people by themselves were ultimately capable of committing an act of terrorism. And what's important to realize, too, is that we have yet to see an example. So the FBI is afraid that there will be this guy in his basement who decides to commit an act of terrorism and meets an Al-Qaeda operative or somehow gets the capability to commit an act of terrorism and goes out and does it. And so these sting operations are meant to prevent that from happening. But we have yet to see a case where that's happened. We have yet to see a case where someone like Derek Sharif, whose capacity was stabbing someone with a steak knife, meets an Al-Qaeda operative and says, hey, here's a bomb. Would you like to deliver it somewhere? That just hasn't happened. And so as a result, the FBI is using these sting operations, and they're the only ones making the crimes possible. You know, these sting operations are really an evolution of drug stings from the 1980s, which I'm sure you've all seen, like from Hollywood movies where, you know, some guy is in a Miami high-rise and he's got a briefcase and 2 guys come in expecting the briefcase to be full of cocaine and they're going to buy it. And they hand over the cash, the guy hands over the briefcase and it's empty and the FBI agents storm in and arrest him. And that's a legitimate law enforcement tactic. But the difference between that and terrorism stings are an evolution of that because basically instead of an empty briefcase, it's an inert bomb. But in drug stings, if the FBI didn't catch someone wanting to buy or sell drugs, that person would find another place to buy and sell drugs. I mean, buying and selling drugs is not difficult in the United States. By contrast, terrorism cases are nothing like that. There is yet to be a case where that person who wants to commit an act of terrorism finds that person who's going to give them the bomb. And so for that reason, the FBI becomes the only one who's actually facilitating these types of crimes, unlike drug stings, for example. And I've thought a lot about why the FBI does this, and I've asked a lot to the FBI. And the conclusion I've come to is that there's no one at the FBI who says, you know, we really want to stick it to the Muslim community. We just dislike these guys, and we're going to drum up crimes. That's not happening. But this is really more of a bureaucratic evil. And by that, I mean every year Congress sets the budget of the FBI. And since 9/11, the lion's share has gone to counterterrorism efforts. You know, right now, this year, the FBI gets $3 billion for counterterrorism, which is more than it gets for organized crime, financial fraud, the typical areas of FBI investigation. And so the FBI can't go and say to Congress and the public, you know, we spent your $3 billion and we didn't find any terrorists. It's not very good business. So FBI stings, by contrast, provide a very convenient mechanism for the FBI to say, hey, look at us. We're doing our job. We're keeping you safe. And I know this is a fact because you can see it in the testimony of Robert Mueller, the FBI director. Every year, Robert Mueller goes to Congress and he justifies how the Bureau did, why they did what they did. And when he talks about counterterrorism, he talks about a case here that I'm sure many of you know about, the so-called Newburgh Four. There are four African-American converts who plotted with an FBI informant to bomb synagogues in Riverdale. And Mueller describes this as a horrible, horrible thing. And it would have been horrible had it been real and had it happened. And he tells Congress about it and as a way of saying, look, we're doing our jobs. But what he doesn't tell Congress and what he doesn't tell the public is that in that actual sting operation, there came a time when the FBI was concerned that the whole thing was going to fall apart. And they wanted a backup charge. And they go to the lead defendant, a guy named James Cromedy, who was a Walmart stalker with a history of mental problems, and gave him $300 and said, hey, go buy a gun, because Cromedy had served a drug offense, and if he had a gun, it would have been a crime. And Cromedy takes the $300, wants to impress the FBI informant, and goes out around New York and tries to buy a gun, and ultimately can't. And he comes back the next day and gives the money back to the informant, who was posing as a terrorist operative, and says, sorry, couldn't get the gun. And so this is a man that the FBI director goes to the public and Congress and says, this was a dangerous terrorist. He was about to bomb synagogues in the Bronx. But how dangerous can a terrorist be who, with $300 in his pocket, can't even buy a gun in New York City? I mean, I don't think anyone would argue that being able to buy a gun is an incredibly difficult thing. But James Cromedy couldn't do it, yet he's a terrorist who's serving 25 years in prison for playing a part in a plot to bomb synagogues in the Bronx. And that's typical of all of these cases. You know, all of the people have capacity to varying degrees, but there are many that have no capacity at all and seem to be really what I would call dupes, people on the fringes. You know, just as a few examples, you know, there was a man in Seattle who was lured into a sting who had schizoaffective disorder. He had trouble distinguishing between reality and fantasy. And an informant who was actually a convicted child molester led him in a plot to attack a military recruiting base in Seattle. You know, just today, actually, there's a case in Portland, Oregon, involving a man named Mohammed Osman Mohammed, who plotted to bomb a Christmas tree lighting ceremony. An informant provided everything he needed. And in the middle of the plot, he was about to run out of money and be evicted from his apartment. And the FBI said, no, don't worry about that. Here's some money to keep you in your apartment. And he went forward with the plot and actually was found guilty today. And what's interesting about it is that all of these cases, I think, to the average person seem like, well, this is entrapment. None of these people could have done their crimes. This is obviously entrapment. But the courts haven't seen it that way. And ultimately, I think it comes down to a couple of things, one being the difference between what you and I would think of as entrapment. Like, a layperson would see this and say that's entrapment, but, you know, the people in the room who are lawyers and all of you studying law, I mean, you can obviously know that the legal definition of that is something very different. And what it's come down to in these terrorism cases has really been predisposition. So in these entrapment cases, the government has to show that this person was predisposed to the crime, or he was not overwhelmed by the informant in some way, that he wanted to commit this crime. And what the government has been very successful in doing in these cases is being able to use a rather absurd logic, which is that if you watch jihadi videos, which is the evidence that they used in the Muhammad case, then you are potentially self-radicalizing. So, you know, the idea being that these jihadi videos are so powerful that if you watch them, or if certain people watch them, then they will become terrorists. Obviously, that's absurd, right? I've watched jihadi videos. I think many people in this room have watched jihadi videos. I mean, I don't think anyone's necessarily going to commit an act of terrorism because of it. But the government is able to get away with that with juries, because I think what happens in these cases is that they, in arguing entrapment, in addition to the predisposition problem, the jury has to be sympathetic to the person who's arguing entrapment. And these people are caught on tape saying awful, awful things, all of which are obviously protected by the First Amendment, but they're really terrible, right? They say anti-Semitic things, they say they want to kill Americans, they say all types of terrible, terrible things. And a jury hears that. At the same time, they're hearing of this horrible, horrible plot to bomb a downtown skyscraper, to bomb a subway, and it's easy to think, well, that could be me, or I could work there. And so far, they've just been unable to win on entrapment at all. And I think this case that's just announced today in Portland kind of raises a significant question of whether entrapment is at all possible in these cases. And what we've seen as a result of this, I think, is a steady increase in the depth that the FBI is willing to go to bring these cases. You know, if you look at, as part of this research, I put all the 10 years worth of data and I laid it out and scaled it and looked at how many sting cases involved informants and how many sting killings were there each year and how many of them involved agent provocateurs where even the idea was supplied by the informant. And what we've seen is a real steady escalation over the years to full agent provocateur, where these men don't have the idea, they don't have the means, and the FBI informant provides everything they need. And because there hasn't been pushback in the public, and because the FBI is winning these cases in court, they have every reason to continue with this tactic, right? Like there's only two ways you can really check the FBI, it's through Congress or the courts. And so the courts are giving the pass. The courts are saying, these are good cases, we're giving convictions, and so then the FBI isn't checking itself. And then in turn, the Congress isn't doing much about it either. But I think what we're slowly seeing, which I think is a very interesting development, has been a shift in the media conversation about these cases. You know, the recent case here, Kwasi Nafis, who plotted with an informant to bomb the New York Federal Reserve building. He didn't have anything. The FBI, like in all these other cases, provided everything he needed, the bomb, the van, everything. In the fifth paragraph of the New York Times story announcing that case, there was a very meaty description of the problems in these cases. And I think what we've seen is a clear shift where the media is becoming far more skeptical of these types of cases. Actually, also when the Nafis case was announced, Foreign Policy magazine, not exactly a bastion of liberal journalism, had a blog item titled, "How many idiot jihadis can the FBI fool?" And I think that is the question. And I think what we're ultimately seeing in these cases is that the public is becoming more aware of how ridiculous these are, that the people, and through the media, I mean, and that the people who commit these crimes never have the capacity on their own. But I think particularly relevant to this audience is what effect this has had in Muslim communities. And if you look at these cases, it's had a couple of, you know, pretty nasty effects. One has been that through these cases, the FBI is almost singularly targeting Muslim communities. You know, the FBI has a program called domain management where they can look at any city and say, where do Italians live? Where do Muslims live? And they can find those exact neighborhoods. And potentially they can assign informants to those neighborhoods. And over the last decade, the FBI has been very aggressive in recruiting informants within Muslim communities through immigration, for example, or criminal charges, and then incentivizing those informants to find terrorists. So what ultimately happens is an informant under great pressure finds the most vulnerable person in the community, such, you know, someone who, as I said, mental illness, others economically desperate, and then lures them along in these terrorist plots. And then it becomes a self-fulfilling thing. The FBI gets all this money. They have pressure from the top to build cases. They put that pressure down on FBI agents. Those FBI agents put that pressure on informants. Those informants then look in Muslim communities and they find these cases. And then the next year, FBI can go back to Congress and say, look at all the great work we did. Look at the terrorist plots that we foiled. And obviously, I don't think this is good public policy. I'm very critical of this. But that isn't a view that's shared by much of the government. You know, one of the things that I've found is that this book so far, it's only been out a couple of weeks, has really received mixed reviews. Michael German, who is a former FBI agent, works for the ACLU, wrote a very good review and said it was great. The Wall Street Journal, by contrast, totally panned it, said it was the worst thing you could read. And the man who wrote it was an FBI agent named Ali Soufan. And I started talking about it because I think it's what Ali wrote about is what the government's take on it is. And in a way, it proves my point. So Ali wrote in his review that I tried to make the case that there is no threat of terrorism in the United States. I clearly don't. That's a lie. I talk about these handful of cases that were real dangers. But in his review, Ali says, well, there are real dangers out there. There's Faisal Shahzad, the Times Square bomber. There's Richard Reid, the shoe bomber. And that's why we should conduct these terrorism sting operations. But what Ali Soufan and other critics of this work never say when they use this argument is that Richard Reid and Faisal Shahzad were not caught in sting operations. Ultimately, in a way, it proves my point because there are real terrorists out there. They're just not being caught in these FBI sting operations. And these FBI sting operations are really only empowering people who, on their own, never would have had the capacity. Because, I mean, let's face it, it's really easy to commit an act of terrorism in the United States. Someone could get a gun and come into this room, and it would be awful. And that's what happened in Sandy Hook. That's what happened in Colorado. But if you look at, you know, the number of people who died since 9/11, far more people have died at the hands of a lone gunman, like in Colorado and Connecticut, than by a lone wolf terrorist with Al-Qaeda sympathies. And that either suggests one of two things, I think. It either suggests that the FBI is perfect, that every terrorist of tomorrow is caught today and they're saving us, which is hard to believe. Or it suggests that the threat that the FBI says exists, that the government says exists, doesn't exist, because it isn't very hard to commit an act of terrorism. And so by finding these people on the fringes who are like Derek Sherif, capable of only stabbing a man with a steak knife, they're ultimately bringing in people and turning them into terrorists when they never had that capacity on their own. And I think one of the big issues in this is what I think this book is about, and what I think this research is about, is as much about terrorism as it is about justice and the administration of justice and the fairness of justice. Because these guys are terrorists only in the most general sense, right? They're terrorists because the FBI allowed them to become terrorists through these sting operations. So then it becomes a question of justice. And what happens in these cases is that you have a justice system that's flawed on several levels. On one level, you have an informant who can make up to $100,000 in a case and has a financial incentive to find terrorists, go and find terrorists, and then testify in court about how they were terrorists and the terrible things they did, while all the while he's being paid for it, right? It's a terrible conflict of interest. Then the other question is a matter of the use of minimum sentencing guidelines. So for example, in the federal system, every crime, as the lawyers in this room know, has a particular legislatively set mandatory minimum. You do this crime, you get convicted of it, you're gonna be sentenced this much time. Because the FBI controls the sting operation, they can introduce whatever they want. So they could introduce a terrorist plot that just involves maybe a handgun, and it would qualify for a certain mandatory minimum. But in these terrorist plots, they actually, you know, if you're gonna conduct a terrorist plot in the FBI's view, you might as well go all the way. So they involve huge bombs, they involve Stinger missiles, they involve these terrible, terrible weapons that even the most sophisticated criminal organization would have difficulty obtaining, but yet this lone wolf terrorist is able to get it through these sting operations, and that ultimately subjects him to mandatory minimums that are just draconian, 25, 35 years. And what's happened in a lot of these cases, and it's a real impediment to my research, is that many of them don't go to trial, so I don't get all the information about what happened in them because it's not released as evidence. And they don't go to trial because someone like Derek Sherif, who pled guilty and is serving a prison sentence, has a really tough decision to make. He's a Muslim after 9/11, accused of terrorism, and if he gets convicted, he could serve 35, 50, in some cases, life in prison. Or he cut a deal and serve 12, 20 years in prison. And what we're seeing over and over again is that most people choose the deal, thinking that they'll never be able to get off at trial. And this further emboldens the FBI because convictions are, to a certain degree, allow for a justification of the process. And so I think this becomes a real kind of tragedy of the legal system, that we are, and this becomes a story about justice as much as terrorism. And so in talking about this book, and I'll try to close it up here because I feel like I've gone on a little bit too long, you know, one of the things I really hope to get out of this is, you know, if you read the book or not, or you sat on this discussion, I hope what it leaves you with is an immediate skepticism of the government when it announces terrorism cases. For me, you know, I can almost spot them. Like every time a terrorism case is announced, It's almost, reading the affidavit is almost like reading Mad Libs. You know, who is the informant? Where did they recruit him? On what message board did they find this guy? And it's always the same. And so the questions to ask in yourself and look for in the stories when these cases are announced are, was there an informant used? What role did he play? Were the people accused of terrorism in any way connected to international terrorists? In most cases, the only connection they have is the informant who's posing as a terrorist operative. And then what capacity they would have had on their own had it not been for the FBI. So as I mentioned, in many of these cases, if not most, they are financially destitute. You know, I mean, someone who's about to be evicted from their apartment is not going to be able to acquire the bomb that even that sophisticated criminal organization could get. But yet that happens. And you know, the most recent case being this Federal Reserve case, and then there was another one even before that involving a case in Miami where the government is charging a Miami man for coming to New York and surveilling buildings to attack in New York, and all he really did was he rode his bike around Manhattan and he comes back to the informant and tells him about the big buildings he saw. That's not a man who's necessarily going to commit an act of terrorism, and when he got back to Miami, he goes back to his job of buying used bikes and fixing them up and selling them on Craigslist. And in case after case, what we're seeing are these. You know, there is a real threat out there. Al-Qaeda is a threat. There's always a potential that there will be another Faisal Shahzad. But of the 500 cases, there have been very few. And so what I make the case for in the book is that maybe it's now a time that we start to realize that, yes, Al-Qaeda is a threat, but it's not the threat that we've made it out to be. And that these sting operations are really not only ruining the lives of the many men that they send to prison, but ultimately not keeping us any safer. Because none of these men, I would argue, would have ever become terrorists were it not for the FBI. And none of these men, so far, have ever actually met a real Al-Qaeda operative who provided them with the capacity. It just hasn't happened yet. It could certainly happen, but it hasn't happened yet. And so the FBI's big fear that a lone wolf will meet an Al-Qaeda operative and that Al-Qaeda operative will give him everything he needs to bomb Columbia University or bomb another building. That's just not happened. And so I think at what point have we created the very enemy that we're hunting and we're afraid of? And what I try to make the case for in the book is that, yes, there are terrorists out there, but so many of the men that you've been told are terrorists, that the government has portrayed as terrorists, were actually nothing more than men who were manufactured to be terrorists by the FBI that is under great pressure to build terrorism cases. And what we have essentially is, you know, a big circle. The money comes in, they need cases, and then we get Derek Sherif. And there aren't many people willing to speak up for Derek Sherif. So far, the justice system hasn't been willing to give these guys much of a chance, and that's why we have an almost near-perfect record of conviction in these cases. And I think what this most recent verdict in Portland shows us is that that's probably likely to continue, and that these sting cases are probably likely to continue well into the future, because now I don't think the FBI feels that entrapment will ever work in these cases. And there's really no one pushing them back to say, no, you shouldn't do this anymore. And then they have the very convenient and effective mechanism of bragging about how they do great work by talking about the terrorism sting that they just announced and then describing it in horrific detail to the public, with the press dutifully reporting that along the way. But I do, as I said, I do think there's a shift. I think it's slowly shifting the other way, where people are more wary of these cases and skeptical of these cases, but certainly it still has a long way to go. So with that, I'd certainly like to open it up to questions. I really appreciate everyone here. I'm really flattered that there's so much interest in the book. I think these things work much better when they're kind of a discussion as well, instead of a lecture. So I'd love to answer any questions anyone might have.
We're grateful to have this space to have an open discussion and to have contributions from a variety of members of the community and from Trevor. It's quite important to be able to openly discuss these issues regardless of the perspective people are coming from. So with that, I want to open it up to questions. We'll take your questions one at a time. Please make them questions, and we'll deal with them as they come.
So, thank you. If you could introduce yourself, that'd be great.
Sure, my name's Arun Kundani. I'm a writer. Thank you for your work on these issues. You mentioned that you saw the kind of origins of this coming out of the drug stings. But I wonder if, to what extent you think that things like COINTEL Pro were very similar. And you said that the targeting of individuals is on the basis of vulnerability. But I wonder if you think that, like with COINTEL Pro, there's also a dimension to it of people who are speaking out politically. For example, I'm thinking of Imam Luqman in Detroit, who was actually killed in a sting operation, right? Who seems to have been targeted not because of kind of mental health issues or anything like that, but because he was exercising his First Amendment rights to make political statements.
Right. Yeah, I think, I mean, obviously this went on in COINTELPRO. I mean, the most recent, it came out recently, right, that Richard Aoki, you know, who was believed to be a great leader in the Black Panther movement, actually was working for the FBI. And so we've seen these tactics before. I don't see a lot of cases like the one you mentioned. I mean, there is that case as a really good example. There are a lot of questions that are unanswered about that case still. But what you're seeing more is that people are using their First Amendment rights, but not so much for political activism like in that case. I mean, it tends to be more the case that someone's saying something extremist or talking about violence in some way, whether it's on some kind of website, or in the case of this man in Baltimore named Antonio Martinez, you know, he put on Facebook some really inflammatory things that were just typo-riddled, and an informant then said, well, we should look into this guy, and that was enough to spark the investigation. So there really is a First Amendment question here. I mean, obviously, it's not illegal to say any of these things, but the FBI is using that as cause to start some kind of a threat assessment, where they get 72 hours to be able to prove a predicate, the predicate being that they believe that he wants to commit some crime. So if someone expresses their First Amendment right, it's an unpopular view. Obviously, I think it's an odious view, but you know, it's certainly protected by the First Amendment right. And then they take that 72 hours to target them. So there is that element to it. I haven't seen much, though, you know, examples of where there's been, you know, political speech. For the most part, the people they are targeting aren't really engaged, like the imam in Detroit. That, you know, they're kind of on the fringes of society, just kind of living day to day. And you know, for whatever reason, have these ideas, and then are targeted in part through the expression of those ideas.
Hi, my name is Alwyn, I'm a student, and I read your book, and I found that you were not really explaining how the FBI easily provides money to its super informants, and I'm thinking especially of the case of Shahid Hussein in Albany. So I was wondering if it's because you did not have access to this kind of information during your investigation, or if it was related to something else.
No, that's a great question, and that's one of the difficulties of this research, which is that you can't put in a FOIA request to the FBI and ask for the names of informants and how much money they've been paid. That's all, that's not released. The only way it ever comes out is in dribs and drabs, and that's through trial. So we know in Shahid Hussein's case, because of the Newburgh 4 trial, he testified to how much money he made, which I think was $96,000 plus a performance incentive, which was never disclosed. And so we can draw conclusions about how much informants are making based on, you know, what they disclose of how much they made. You know, there are other cases. There was a case involving a sting in Lodi, California, where the informant made $300,000. I mean, you can make a lot of money as a terrorism informant, but what we don't have is a full and complete data set of that exactly. And you know, it's one of the things obviously I would love to get my hands on, but that information is only, we're only able to get it when the opportunity arises, such as through these trials, and when the defense attorneys draw it out, get them to testify to how much they were paid. But because there's so many guilty pleas, that happens in so few cases. So there's a whole, you know, obviously dozens of cases where we're not sure who the informant was because his name was never disclosed and we don't know how much money he made. And then obviously the question I try to raise in the book and here is that's a justice question too, right? This person has a financial incentive in seeing this man convicted, and he's going before a jury and saying, you know, this is what happened, and he's got a dog in the race, right? He wants to see him convicted, and so there's a question of how much of that is going to color his testimony, and how fair is it that he's testifying against these people. But I would love, and I think, you know, as these, if more cases go to trial, that is the thing to look for. How much money were these guys paid? And a good defense attorney usually draws that out, because what they want to show is that this person isn't speaking out of truth, he's speaking because he's got the financial motivation.
Hi there, I'm Julia Anglin. I'm from the Wall Street Journal. I don't write the reviews. I wanted to know if there were any judges that were fighting back. I know there was one case the guy who tried to sneak across the border before 9/11, and the judge threw out the mandatory sentence three times. I'm wondering if there are more like that.
You know, there was a case that was just announced, or it was just thrown out in Miami, involving two men at a mosque in Broward County, just in the county north of Miami-Dade, who were accused of funneling money to terrorist organizations, and that was thrown out for lack of evidence just before it went to trial. But we aren't seeing a lot of that. You know, in fact, in the Newberg case that we mentioned a couple times, the judge in the case paid a lot of lip service to it. I think she said the defendant's buffoonery was so Shakespearean in scope that he should have been, that no real terrorist would ever have enlisted him. But then, you know, she talks about that, but then she didn't agree to a downward departure. She stuck to the guidelines. There's a long pending appeal in the Lodi sting. I think it was heard maybe 18 months ago, if not 2 years ago, and they're still waiting for a ruling. But you can speculate as to why, but there really hasn't been much pushback from judges in these cases.
Can I sneak in a question?
Yeah.
One question I have is, can you imagine a sting operation that you would consider a success? That is to say, you've pointed out five real terrorists that, you know, found everything they needed on their own, tried to do something, and then didn't succeed. Can you imagine a situation where the FBI actually tries to go out and get someone in a sting operation like this that you would kind of consider okay?
Well, there hasn't been yet an example where the FBI has used a sting operation on people that had the weapons themselves. You know, you could maybe talk about the Fort Dix case because they had access to weapons, but they ultimately were encouraged to go get them by the informant egging them on. And in the end, all they could really procure was a few handguns. But there hasn't been a case yet where someone had a bomb and was going to deliver it, you know, in a set period of time, and the FBI informant through the sting operation foiled that plot. It's typically and almost universally the case that the entire means is provided by the FBI in these cases. And so for that reason, that's why I question, you know, there obviously are people that are capable and dangerous. There's Faisal Shahzad, there's Najibul Azazi, but the sting operations aren't getting them. The sting operations are ultimately getting these others, and we're not seeing any cases like that yet anyway.
What I go to a lot of these talks, what I've gleaned is that they're trying to demonize the homeless of the community and to get people's attention on that topic rather than maybe they get economic. But my question is that with the Holy Land Five, they were using a lot of secret evidence. There was one, I believe, an anonymous Israeli agent that they wouldn't even name. They was given secret evidence and wasn't even open up to the defense lawyers. So how do you deal with secret evidence?
Yeah, it's a good question. And it's come up a couple times. In the Yes in a Ref case in Albany, there was also secret evidence that was submitted. In other cases, there's been kind of an illusion of, you know, this guy's a terrorist, like this most recent case in Portland. He was in contact with a man who was detained by Saudi officials, and the prosecutors made a big deal about he was detained by Saudi officials, but it was unclear. It was never clear why he was detained by Saudi officials. I mean, the implication, obviously, that the government was trying to plant in the jury was, well, he must have been a terrorist if the Saudis detained him. But for the most part, you know, these aren't like the Guantanamo cases, you know, where there's a lot of secret. There have been examples like that, like Holy Land and Iraq. But for the most part, and I think it's almost, in a weird way, the government's implicit way of saying, you know, these cases are different, is that because they never have actual connections to terrorist organizations, that the only connection is the informant, there really isn't an issue of secret evidence in most of these cases, because the only terrorist was the informant, so there's really no terrorists involved. And so for the most part, most of the evidence ends up coming out, and it's only a few of those cases where there is some alleged connection to terrorism, and then they use secret evidence. In the Albany case, for example, the defense never saw it either. The implications of that are probably best, you know, discussed by a lawyer, but obviously it raises significant questions of how you can have a fair trial if you're not seeing all of the evidence.
I promise I didn't take the mic for plugs, but if you guys sign up to the e-newsletter sign-up sheet outside, you'll actually hear more information about an event planned for March 31st about terrorism prosecutions. So again, if you guys keep up with the network of co-sponsors and the Columbia Human Rights Institute, there are many more events that talk about these issues. And if you're a questioner, just go ahead and raise your hand. I'm gonna try and spot you guys for the rest of the evening.
Hello, my name is August. I just wanted to come off of, like, follow up on what the first man asked, or rather stated in terms of the counterintelligence program, COINTELPRO, and point out that the FBI did recently, or it was recently found out that the FBI considered Occupy Wall Street to be a potential terrorist threat, and that they did infiltrate and do surveillance within that movement. And I just wanted to kind of ask you to please, I don't know, maybe continue with this idea of the reason that they're going about doing this. You described it as a bureaucratic evil rather than like some conspiracy against Muslims. But don't we have to really give it a political context in terms of justifying the climate of fear in order to justify the way that the US government is in fact terrorizing the peoples of the world with its military apparatus, over like 1,100 known military bases outside of its own borders?
On the issue you talked about, like targeting Occupy Wall Street, you know, one of the things I do talk about in the book is that you're right, this isn't, these types of tactics aren't exclusive to Muslim communities and Islamic terrorism. We are seeing them with, you know, so-called anarchists and environmental activists. You know, there was this case out of Cleveland a few months ago where I think it was seven guys plotted to bomb a bridge over the Cuyahoga River. They didn't have any capacity on their own, like these other cases involving Islamic terrorism. It ended up being that the FBI informant provided all of the means that they needed. I do talk about in the book, there does seem to be a favoring of the FBI in targeting in these sting operations, not just Muslims, but when they're looking at these cases, there tends to be more that would consider of like activists on the left, environmental activists, anarchists. And what we aren't seeing as much of that is these types of sting operations used in white supremacist movements and the sovereign citizen movement, for example. You know, for example, it took, and the sovereign citizens are these group of men who, men and women who believe that you can just opt out of U.S. laws, and you know that basically your subjugation to U.S. laws can be opted out through, like, you know, filing some crazy documents with the court. And most of them are very paranoid, and they think because they've tried to opt out of U.S. law that they are being hunted by police, and they stockpile weapons. And there was an incident in West Memphis, Arkansas, where a sovereign citizen killed two police officers in a scuffle, and it took that for the FBI to finally, you know, announce that they do view sovereign citizens as a threat, you know, even though there's been evidence to suggest that sovereign citizens are more of a threat. So I think there's been a slower movement in recognizing those threats as there has been for the FBI in viewing, you know, Earth First and environmental activists as threats. But I don't get into any of that in the book as far as, you know, environmental activists, but they're using similar tactics in these cases. I don't mean to give the suggestion that this is exclusive to Muslim communities. It's used most often in these types of, you know, as far as terrorism, used most often involving Islamic terrorism in Muslim communities, but it is used elsewhere as well.
Is this working? Right. I'm Noreen Shah. I work here at the Human Rights Institute. Trevor, I'm going to sneak in two questions.
Okay.
One is, you know, your book is one of the first that really documents informants all over the country. Can you draw a line between what is a reasonable suspicion that informants are infiltrating a mosque or a setting like this, and just paranoia? And how do you do it when even the ACLU has only been able to document really sporadic instances where there's proof that there are informants? My second question is, the book is about informants, but of course we know there's lots of other kinds of cases, the Holy Land Five Foundation case that has been mentioned, the material support cases like that of Tariq Mahana in Boston. They don't involve the use of informants, but they do involve, in a sense, the criminalization of speech. What do you think the connections are between these cases, and how can we be leveraging the very sympathetic informant cases to also make an impact on the cases that are about speech, but speech by political activists?
Right. So I do think, obviously, there is paranoia. I mean, the perception in Muslim communities around the nation, I think, is that FBI is looking at you. They're informants in the mosque. You know, when we talked earlier, the joke I've heard several times is when I pray on Friday, I sometimes think the guy next to me is a mosque. I'm sorry, is an informant. But the truth is that working an informant from the FBI, for the FBI is difficult. There's a lot of paperwork involved. So even though there's an extraordinary number and a historic number of informants employed by the FBI today, it's 15,000, there aren't so many that they're in every corner of Muslim communities nationwide. And so the belief that there's always an informant there probably is to a certain degree paranoia, but it's also to a certain degree purposeful by the FBI, because in addition to these sting operations, the FBI's view is that they want to create a hostile environment for would-be terrorists. So by having people fear that there's an informant around, that if you are a real terrorist and you are in a Muslim community and you're collaborating with someone, they want to instill the fear that you're thinking, well, is that guy an informant? Is he working for the government? And, under the broken windows theory of law enforcement, this creates a hostile environment for these types of crimes. But the flip side of that, obviously, is that it disenfranchises an entire minority community in the United States, making them feel that they are being unfairly targeted in ways that other communities are not. I make the case in the book that I think this has an effect on law enforcement you can't fully measure. You can't know what kind of information you're missing by, Muslims being willing to tell you about things that are going on in their community because they don't want to, because they're afraid that they will ultimately be recruited as an informant or drawn into some sting operation. And so that deafening effect that it's had, I think, is an interesting thing to think about. As far as the other cases, I would make the argument that they're linked, like Tariq Mahana, for example. They were trying to recruit him to be an informant, and they brought those charges against him ultimately, if you believe fully what Mahana says, in retaliation, that he didn't become an informant on his friend who was believed to have traveled overseas to train at a terrorist camp. And in that case, that the question is, did they obviously criminalize speech? I mean, nothing that Mahana did was anything more than, translate text and put text online. And I think the other thing that's happening, obviously, and I don't get this into this much in the book, is, when you mentioned the Holy Land Foundation, I've heard from Muslims that there's a real kind of concern about donating to organizations that you're not absolutely sure about, right? Like, if your charity's going to an organization that you're not quite sure where the money's going because of the Holy Land Foundation, it really stifles the amount of money that flows to organizations maybe other than the Red Crescent and organizations that are very well known. And I think that has an effect, on the Muslim community's ability to, raise money for the purposes that it wants. Whether that's at all purposeful for the FBI, it's hard to speculate. I mean, I think the troubling thing about the Holy Land case was that, if I'm saying this right, it set the precedent that, the government, all the government had to say is that your dollar spent to fund a church is one less dollar that the organization, to fund a school is one less dollar that the Hamas needs to, buy weapons, and so you're able to prosecute them under that case. And I don't know. It is a really interesting case. I do view those as somewhat separate than these sting operations, although I think there's overlap, such as the Mahana case, where, what we have seen in several of these things, in several of these cases, are people that they've tried to recruit as informants, they're not able to, and then using charges against them to get them to recruit as informants. And then if they were able to recruit them, they would use them in these sting operations. And I think that's likely what they had in mind for Tariq Mahana if they were able to get him to cooperate. They would have used him as an informant and gotten him to work off those charges as an informant in another type of sting operation.
So you guys shouldn't have given me a mic, but this is a good time for a PSA. We do have some Know Your Rights guides outside, but FYI, and law students should definitely know this, if you're ever approached by a member of law enforcement, especially a member of the FBI, you should always insist on having an attorney present before answering any questions. Many of the people that were put in a situation that was just described usually had long engagement with members of law enforcement before they realized that they might have gotten themselves into trouble. So it's always wise to seek an attorney's counsel before speaking to members of law enforcement.
Thanks. My name's Daryl Lee. I'm an adjunct lecturer at the law school here. I have a comment and a question, actually. My comment is that it was interesting to hear from you that you got this negative review from Ali Safan in the Wall Street Journal, because for many U.S. liberals, he was elevated into a kind of hero in the torture debates. And I think that speaks to a broader problem that's kind of coming to a head here, which is that during the Bush administration, the dominance of kind of U.S. liberals in these debates had this unfortunate side effect of sometimes presenting an idealized image of the US criminal justice system, right? So Guantanamo is this legal black hole, it's a terrible place, and why don't we just give them, you know, it's a violation of long-standing American values, you know, all those kinds of arguments, and that what we really should do is we should give them the kind of gold standard of justice, the United States is a leader in the world, Article III courts, the criminal justice system. And I think what this, what your book does is it brings out all of the multiple problems with the US criminal justice system that are connected, as other commenters have noted, to the broader war on drugs, racialized mass incarceration, surveillance of political dissidents, et cetera, et cetera. So I think that's another sort of important part of one of the troubling things that you're raising for people like myself who are teaching or working or writing in the international human rights community is how do we move beyond these very limited discourses of, you know, Guantanamo is terrible, the other stuff is less bad, and therefore we're not really sure what the best way is to challenge it. My question is, you spent most of your talk on criminal prosecutions, and oftentimes, so legally speaking, we're often looking through the lens of the defense attorney. And I'm wondering if you could speak about actual or potential cases of civil litigation where we kind of get to go on the offensive, as it were. So the case that I'm thinking of is this insane story from Southern California,
right,
where the FBI informant tried to plant some crazy idea in the minds of local Muslim members of the Muslim community, who then informed on the informant to the FBI, and then the informant turned against the FBI. They filed this lawsuit, and the suit was thrown out on the basis of the state secrets doctrine, which up until that point had mostly been seen in the war on terror context for the CIA rendition stuff and the overseas stuff, and now it was being brought into the domestic law enforcement context. And I believe the case is still on appeal, but I was wondering if you could speak to that case or other actual or potential civil litigation as a way to put pressure on the government or to extract more information. Because it seems like when you get to the criminal prosecution thing, as you said, I mean, there's very little that can be done. People are forced to take plea deals and that's it.
Right, right. So the case you're referring to is, it was a DEA informant turned FBI informant named Craig Monte, and he had infiltrated Southern California, and he spied on a number of people. He tried to, you know, get, you know, traditional tactics, like we're seeing in these cases, see if they're interested in terrorism. He ultimately built a case around a guy who had a connection to Osama. His brother-in-law was apparently Osama bin Laden's bodyguard in Afghanistan, and they were interested in recruiting him as an informant. And so then they built a terrorism case around him, and ultimately it was thrown out. But what happened to Monte was it was poor handling by the FBI in many ways. And Monte was actually running a scam. You know, as I talk about in the book, like Stephen Trott, the federal appellate judge, describes informants as sociopaths. And I think it's a very good description, because you can't be a good informant unless you're willing to build relationships with people over months and months and then be willing to just betray those relationships for your own personal gain. And so only a sociopath could really do that. And for that reason, informants are terribly unreliable and require all kinds of supervision. And it turned out that the informant in Orange County was running a scam where he was, while working as a terrorism informant, he was a bodybuilder, and he asked these two women to front him money to buy some human growth hormone that he said he could double their money, and I think they gave him a total of a little over $100,000. And then he got busted for it. The women went to the Irvine police saying, you know, we gave him all this money. And when he gets arrested, he's like, no, that was part of an FBI sting. And, you know, of course it was, and it was just his cover for that. And in ways that are kind of dramatic and hard to boil down, it just poisoned the well between them. And Monte kind of went public and said, you know, this is what happened. The FBI intentionally asked me to spy on the community. The difficulty with Monte, in my view, has been that he's a very unreliable source. You know, I think what's happened is that the ACLU and CARE in this lawsuit used him as a way of filing a civil lawsuit saying that the civil liberties of members of the Muslim community were intentionally violated by the FBI through the use of this informant. The problem has been that, you know, Monte himself is very unreliable. You know, that his story has consistently changed. You know, when I first interviewed him a couple of years ago, he said things, and now he's saying other things. But what I think is interesting about it is that it did open up a window into what was going on, into the fact that the FBI was controlling in communities that they had no reason to believe were committing crimes, but using informants to try to see if there were crimes being committed. There was no predisposition, however. And then how the FBI was using informants to recruit other informants. So what Monte talks about is, you know, the FBI asked him to find you know, leverage on people. For example, if someone was having an extramarital affair, or if they, you know, used pornography, to like find about that and then say, well, unless you work with us, we'll, you know, tell the community about all this and try to shame them into becoming an informant. But it is interesting, right, that this was a really kind of, for people that watch these cases, like that was a really interesting one, and that was shot down in the, under the rare state secrets exemption, which, you know, certainly doesn't seem to suggest that the only connection to any terrorism case was very tangential. It was this case involving Osama bin Laden's alleged bodyguard, and it was off in Afghanistan. But most of that case and what Monte did was centered in Southern California. You know, the judge wrote, a rather thoughtful opinion in saying why he agreed with the state secrets and describing having to need that balance. But that is the only civil case I know of other than this other case out of Oregon, where they are challenging the no-fly list and what the ACLU, I think it's ACLU Care suit as well, alleges is that there's really no due process to the no-fly list. That, you know, you get put on the no-fly list and you can't know if you're on. If you are on, you can't appeal your way off of it. And I think what's interesting about that in particular is that there has been allegations that the FBI has used the no-fly list to recruit informants. You know, the case of Aid Marshall in Chicago, where they asked him, they put him on the no-fly list, he shows up at the airport to do his job, he then gets turned away, and then the FBI goes to him and says, you know, if you work with an informant, we can make all of this go away. But the problem has been that, how do you build a case like, you know, a lawyer would be better able to talk about this than I do, but what I see as the problem is, to build a case like CARE is done in the ACLU done in Southern California, you need an informant willing to cooperate with you like the way that Monte did, to testify to like sign affidavits and say, this is what I did. I intentionally spied on people who were practicing their First Amendment rights. Unless there's another case like that, but I think that is a way that ultimately people, ACLU and CARE are fighting back. There just probably aren't a lot of opportunities like that. And when there are opportunities, it involves someone like Monte, who I think ends up hurting the cause a little bit. When I say the cause, I mean the ACLU and CARE's cause, because he was such an unreliable source.
We're just going to take two more, so we'll take one here and the one in front, and then we'll close.
Assalamu alaikum. Mera naam Shahina Parveen Siraj hai, aur main Shahwar Mateen Siraj ki maa hoon. NYPD ne paid informant aur undercover ke zariye PI aur CI ke saath milkar mere bete ke khilaf khud saakta jhoota case terrorism ka banaya. जिसकी वजह से मेरे बेटे को 30 साल की सजा दी गई तो मैं एक क्वेश्चन आपसे करना चाहती हूं कि आपने अपनी बुक में कहीं यह जिक्र किया है कि ये लोग मुसलमानों के खिलाफ इतनी दहशत और नफरत फैला के डर और खौफ अमेरिका के लोगों पर भी मुसलमानों पर भी इतना फैलाया है दुनिया के अंदर ताकि ये अपने गनाउने मकसद जो हैं वो हासिल कर सकें जैसे जंगें हैं जैसे एनवाईबीडी अपनी फंडिंग के लिए करती है या दूसरे और गनाउने मकसद तो इन चीजों का कोई जिक्र है
Greetings of peace. My name is Shahina Parveen Siraj. I'm the mother of Shahwar Mateen Siraj, who was the victim of a NYPD entrapment operation. In which the NYPD informant manufactured the case and for which my son is now serving a 30-year sentence. My question is, through these cases, we see that they create this smearing and targeting of Muslim communities and individuals, which that then they hype up into a frenzy to hype up fear within the U.S. public and within the broader communities. And As it's been raised before, they have their own agendas for it, whether it is just the maintaining of funding, whether it is getting for the legitimacy for the wars abroad or keeping people silent. If we want to address these issues, we can't really bypass these underlying sort of agendas. How much of that do you go into within the book and explore those larger agendas at play?
Yeah, so I don't, you know, obviously whether this is an intentionally to gin up fear, I don't know how you would really get at that. I mean, I don't explore that idea very, very much at all. I mean, I don't think that this is necessarily the, But what I do get at is kind of the, and I mentioned the gentleman quoted me as the bureaucratic evil of this, that I do think that the largest part of it is really, I quote an FBI agent in the book who says, you know, if you spend more money in one area looking for problems, you'll find lots of problems. And I think that's really what this comes to. There is an element of the government overplaying some of these cases when they announce them, whether that's intentionally to build up fear. I mean, that's up for the individual to decide. But you know, there's been some ridiculous things that the government has said. You know, for example, when they indicted the seven men in Miami that were known as the Liberty City Seven, Alberto Gonzalez at the time said that they wanted to declare full ground war on the United States. I mean, that's ridiculous. It's seven guys. How are they going to declare full ground war on the United States? But those are the type of things that the government has said. I mean, when they talk about these cases, they do make them, they play them up for dramatic effect. They also play it up for dramatic effect when they, you know, announce a mob case, for example. So, I mean, it's not exclusive to terrorism cases that they do this. But, I mean, one of the things I try to get at in the book is to explain why this is happening and why they're pursuing these cases. And the argument I make is that it's a bureaucratic thing more than anything else, that there's so much pressure because of the amount of money that's spent on counterterrorism and because it's politically motivated, right? Congress sets the budget, that it's having the net effect of making FBI agents feel pressure to build cases and then putting that pressure on their informants. Their informants end up finding people who are on the fringes of society. And then it pulls FBI agents, as I mentioned, into this gray area where I think we can all be empathetic to a certain degree, where you're an FBI agent, and this guy is saying terrible things. He's saying that he wants to bomb a shopping mall, he wants to bomb a subway station, and do they just say, you know, he'll mature out of it and let him go, and then they find out later that he actually does do it. You know, that hasn't happened yet, but I think we can all put ourselves in the FBI agent's position and think, you don't want to be that guy who says he's not a danger, and then he ultimately commits an act of terrorism. But at the same time, what we can say very definitively is there hasn't yet been that case where someone without the means, such as your son, ends up finding someone who could provide the bomb. Such as in your son's case, it was the informant and the FBI that provided everything he needed. And I find it hard to believe, and no evidence suggested that he would have been able to meet anyone else who could have provided him with that means. And so, just like I mentioned, the comparison with the drug cases, where, you know, if you're not involved in a drug sting, you can find drugs elsewhere. But there is a real question of whether someone like your son could have found the means elsewhere, and there hasn't been that case yet where we could say, yes, there was that guy, no capacity, and he found someone to provide the capacity. That just hasn't happened.
My name is Gabriela Echeverria. I'm a visiting scholar here at the law school. I just have a quick question. I haven't read your book, but from your presentation, I'm a bit confused on what is exactly your criticism. I don't know if the criticism is the actual operations, the fact that they go for potential terrorists and that the government shouldn't go or prosecute or, you know, investigate potential terrorists, but actually people that are committing, you know, acts that, you know, could be terrorist acts, or if your criticism is that the operations are not being effective because they're not targeting the right people, and they are, you know, the threat is there, and as you said, there's like, you know, there's five people that were there, and they're just not getting those people. So if that's the criticism, where do you see is a mistake, or do you think that those operations can be improved?
So I actually, my criticism is both, which is that I criticize the actual people that they're targeting in these operations because they, on their own, do not have any capacity to commit an act of terrorism. They are on the fringes to such a degree that it's highly unlikely that they would be able to ever find the means to commit an act of terrorism. And that crime is ultimately only enabled through the FBI. So the example I first mentioned, you know, Derek Sherif saying he wants to stab someone with a steak knife. Well, that was his capacity. But the FBI, through the sting operation, made it possible for him to commit a crime that on his own he had no capacity to commit. But at the same time, as I said, there are real terrorists, right? But what we can say is that the real terrorists that we find, the real terrorists that Ali Soufan cites in his review, weren't caught in sting operations. So, you know, the question then is, like, are these people that we're catching in sting operations, could they ever become Faiz or Shahzad? The FBI says that's the fear, that would happen. My criticism is that hasn't happened yet. There's little evidence to suggest from the evidence in these cases that could happen. You know, for the most part, the people involved in these cases are just so on the fringes and have such little capability, it's hard to imagine them committing even the most minor offense. And yet through these elaborate sting operations, we make them out to be dangerous terrorists. And so the net effect of that is that we end up presenting to the public a large number of terrorism cases, potentially increase the fear that people have about Islamic terrorism in particular, while not actually catching the real dangers, while not actually catching, you know, the shoe bomber or Najib al-Azazi, for example. I mean, none of these people have been caught in sting operations. So then the question is, how much of this is really keeping us safe, and how much of this is theater that the Bureau is putting on because it's under pressure to build terrorism cases, and it's really empowering people who would have no means. That said, I do want to make clear, like, I think if someone is on a message board and it says they want to commit an act of terrorism, I think there's every reason to monitor them and see if they'll ever become, you know, an operator. I don't think that it's good policy for us to be putting together elaborate sting operations on the off chance that they might one day meet someone and then ultimately, you know, portray them as being so much dangerous than they ever could be.
I want to thank Trevor for joining us.
Thank you.
I want to thank, it's been an honor to host all of the co-sponsors as well, and to allow, you know, a variety of groups to express their own opinions and their ideas. Trevor will be outside and hopefully around to discuss at greater length. And thank you all for coming. Take care.
Yeah, thank you.